Today, I am interviewing TJ Graham, played for NC State, spent 4 years in the NFL, or played four seasons in the NFL, two with the Buffalo Bills, one with the Jets, and what was the fourth one? Sorry, I literally just...
No, you're good. You're good.
Eagles, okay, yes.
I played the Eagles, the Saints still. Put the Saints in there. I played like 10 games with the Saints, and then I was preseason with the Eagles.
Okay.
And I went on to do like a hybrid year between CFL in Carolina towards the end of my career, and then I went on to the CFL for the final three till 2019.
And not to mention, was also a track star in college and high school. How did that incorporate into your recruiting process as far as being a dual sport athlete, having elite track speed? I think what was your fastest time 100 at 10.21. Yeah. So you had elite track speed. What was that recruiting process like? And did you start to favor one sport over the other?
So the recruiting for track and football are like almost completely different. I actually, as like a freshman and sophomore, did not run track. So no one really knew, other than the football teams that I had played, knew how fast I was. But once I started running track as a junior, I had already kind of like slightly committed to NC State in a way. All the other schools were kind of like hesitant to approach me, but the ones that did took like a very track approach, kind of have them come at me with, hey, come to school to run track or you can always play football type of
thing. Yeah.
Like South Carolina, LSU, like Tennessee, any school you can think of that needs some sprinters and that play a little football, like, yeah, all those schools for sure. Like Oregon, places like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So
did it ever cross your mind to put all your energy into track professionally or collegiately, or there's always I wanted to play football and also run track on the side kind of thing?
Well, the unique part about my situation was like my dad's an Olympian, my mom's a professional track runner, and my dad was actually one of the best professional track coaches in the world. He's still one of the best sprint coaches in the world at the moment, right? So he knows a lot about track and field. So it was like one day when I was like 14 and I was a hooper. I thought I was a hooper. I like playing basketball a lot.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I just wanted to always play basketball, but I wasn't always the greatest at it. And kind of sat down and figured out like which sports I liked and which sports I wanted to pursue. My dad knowing and my parents knowing kind of how track is, they kind of were like, you can run it, right? You'll be good.
Yeah.
You'll be good. But you should definitely push for something that uses a little more security. So football was the go after that. That's kind of why I didn't play or run track my freshman or sophomore year. And track was definitely just like, hey, you can go run track now. You've kind of cemented your football stuff, like you're on track. So track was just a compliment to the football stuff, just to basically say like he is fast and he's really fast.
Yeah.
So
and today you have there's a lot of kids, or there's a lot of rhetoric surrounding dual sport versus focusing on one sport. You sometimes see parents telling their kids that they need to focus on football even from the age of 12, and there are some parents like that. And then there's a lot of coaches that say that the best athletes are dual sport athletes. They run track, they play basketball, they play football, they play soccer even. Where do you kind of fall in that argument? And I know you have a young son, so where do you even look to that for him as he's growing up?
Well, being on this side of sport, professional sport, and playing it since I was like 7 years old, right? I'd say diversity is more important than being specialized, right? So there are some situations that you're in and you're thankful that you ran track, right? And there are some certain situations that I'm in, I just say more mentally than physically on the track, that I'm thankful I played football. There are some times in sport where like I'm happy I played basketball, right? Because all those skills that I learned were not skills I may have been able to tap into on the football field or track without crossing over to another sport. And the coolest part, what I actually coach now is a hybrid version of track and football. So me, you're saying it right on my alley of, I think there's a special way to kind of merge those two. And the immersion, kind of just the, you know, combination of them is kind of where the beauty lies. If we can find those overlaps in all sports and train similarly. So like, I was just going off on a tangent. I kind of work in that now with analytics, where we kind of look at different sports, but have similar tendencies. So like a quarterback to a pitcher, baseball player to a golfer swing, to a tennis player swing, all those types of things. And in my specialty, I look at how a sprinter runs compared to how a football player sprints, or a soccer player sprints, or baseball, or anybody sprints on another field. So I think it's important to diversify.
So when a parent comes to you, or if an athlete even comes to you and asks your advice, if like, I think he's, even if it's a, let's say it's a really good athlete like you were, and they come to you and say, do you think I should focus on track versus football while I'm in college? Like a young athlete who's maybe looking to go to the league or even has Olympic dreams. What is your advice to them specifically if they're extremely good at both and could probably go pro in both?
Well, for sure. If they can go pro in both in any sport and they have that ability, you know, they're stuck in that decision, right? I think it's just a matter of which one you want to have the biggest outcome in, right? Mm-hmm. You kind of put your eggs in there. So I never sacrificed football for my track stuff, but that's almost not true because I actually didn't do winter workouts to run track, but I was running track to play better football. That right there was kind of how that worked, where I knew I needed to get in high level velocity and speed training in. So I'm like, track is it. So every time I approached the track, I still lifted weights.
Yeah.
I still moved around. I still wouldn't call it balls. Like, you know, I still wouldn't run some routes with my teammates when I could, but track was just that season. So I actually think that they should figure out a way, if the both of them work together, then take it. But like, if they're two opposite spectrums sometimes, then yeah, it's, you know, you should make a decision. So
did you ever have any coaches who gave you a hard time on that at state, or when it was like, you're spending too much time on the track, we need you more watching film or doing this with the team? Was that ever a part of your experience there?
So earlier on, I felt like as a freshman or sophomore, yes. Right. Even slightly as a junior, right? I feel like I had a little bit of pushback for running track just because it's not understood, right? It's not that they didn't want me to. It's more like, I got to keep these kids healthy. So I want to keep them in places I understand. I don't understand that space. But it wasn't until after my junior season that I kind of had all my ducks in a row, and they didn't have an excuse to tell me no. So I went and ran, and then they saw how well I did during the season because of it. And after that, it was no question, because I kind of solved that. I kind of answered that question of, is this a good thing for our football players? Yes. Like the following year, we had like 3 or 4 more guys go out from the football team. So yeah, I have always been that guy, that track guy that people try to put that stamp on. And I'm like, I can actually move. I can play football. I'm just applying some skills that I got as a, you know, a blessing from my parents.
And you actually had hands too.
Exactly.
Some track guys.
I've dropped some balls, but I also drop as many balls as a regular football player does. I drop way more passes than most track guys. So,
because I've definitely seen, I don't think he was there when you were up at Prolific, but this guy, Dennis, that Ricky's been working with, he was a track guy, A&T. And the first few weeks, and even before I met him, dude could not catch to save his life. But now he's like snagging everything. So I'm like, it shows that catching is definitely something people are just naturally good at, and is also can be a learned skill as far as that goes.
So at my current job right now, I assess like top quarterbacks in the nation. So we need somebody to catch the balls. They're throwing at college level. So you're just not going to have anybody out there catching it. So all the kids call me Hands. Kids call me Hands because of all the people there, I have the best hands. Which is cool, because on some teams I've been like, I haven't always had the best hands compared to my teammates.
Yeah,
like in the real life I can catch anything. So
and it's, you know, you see a lot of guys and why they may not work out in the NFL is just they can't catch. Or even in college too. When it comes to getting recruited, you mentioned your current job now. What is the biggest advice you give to high schoolers, three, four stars like yourself, who have some notoriety on the high school level, or compared to people who either have no stars or there are 1-2-star guys? What is the biggest advice you give them if they were to come to ask you for it?
Well, recruiting advice I actually do give out is I kind of approach it very functional, right? Like kind of put them in scenarios that they understand. So, I mean, I've talked to both genders, right? I've coached both, and I've always explained it kind of like dating, right? It's like dating, like especially high school kids. They're at that point of like, do they like me? Don't they like me? And I'm like, do they know you exist? Right.
Yeah.
So my question is, do they know you exist? Cool. Now they know you exist. Right. So now what qualities are they looking for? All right. Do you fit those qualities? Do you play basketball? She really likes basketball players. Cool. You probably don't play basketball. So you need to figure out a way to get in front of her without playing basketball. All right. You need to figure out a way to get in front of her even on the basketball court, because you're not the only one playing. Right. Are they looking for tall, fast, short, medium? Like what's their scheme? Do you fit their scheme location wise? How far do you have to travel? Right. You know what I'm saying? Like all those things.
Yeah.
So I kind of look at it like that, where if you're trying to get recruited by a college, like you got to look at it like, this is a very pretty girl or pretty guy, right? Mm-hmm. Very, these people that are like popular at your school, you're trying to get their attention. So kind of look at it like that, especially if it's a school you really want to go to, get their attention, you know, highlight things with yourself, constantly be on it. Don't expect them to come looking for you because you're unless you do something that gets their attention, but still, you still need to talk to them as such. That's kind of how I explain it, where you just need to be conversational and show interest, figure out what you do and don't want, figure out what they do and don't want, and align with that.
I feel like you probably definitely or might agree with the fact that your highlights almost don't matter as much as showing up to their camps or talking to them.
Your highlights are what, like, it's like your dress. Like, it's like what gets you seen. You're like, wow, you look great. Yeah. That's so shallow. It's so shallow, right? Like, wow, you have sweet shoes, but let me see what else you have, right? Let's see how your grades are. Let's see what kind of character person you are, right?
Yeah.
See what type of teammate you are and see what your work ethic is, right? Because you can fool me with a sweet outfit for one day, but is your outfit fire every single day, right?
Yeah.
Like, what's your style? So, like, highlights are glimpses into what you can do, but consistently, what does a game look like? Mm-hmm. Like, what does a full game look like? How do you put together a full game? Like, are you blocking? Are you catching a few highlights, but you're making a lot of errors somewhere else? Like, do you know your plays type of stuff? If we're talking football, right?
Yeah.
Other sports, basically just kind of, you know, think about it as consistency, like consistently show up. If your highlight tape, if you can't make a short highlight tape because you have too many highlights, that's a really good problem.
Yeah.
That's a good problem, right? But if you cannot create a highlight tape long enough that kind of puts together a consistent flow, then you need to dig down deep and, you know, work on it, because you don't want to get in a car and drive it 10% of the time or 20% of the time. You want it to turn on 100% of the time. Mm-hmm. So recruiting wise, you want somebody that's going to catch the ball 100% of the time, at least 90 plus.
So when you're watching, or when you're working with quarterbacks and receivers and you're watching receivers film, what do you think are the most important intangibles, whether skills required for a receiver to be successful in the next level for college, and then also the pros? Is it their route running ability, the scope of their route tree, their speed? What do you think is the most important thing also that a coach can maybe mold into an elite receiver on the next level?
Well, what's cool about that question is because, like, every athlete to some degree needs to figure that out. They need to figure out like what their specialty is themselves. So I think that's very important as well, like knowing what you bring to the table so that you can pinpoint things. So like working with spring up Thayer Thomas from the other day, right? So Thayer is actually a good football player. He was a good football player before I met him. I saw him run around. I'm like, you're a good football player, right? Now, the question you asked was like, what things they need to highlight and work on. Like, he's already situationally, and he's a very intellectual football player. I think that's important to understand the game, whatever sport you're playing, to that degree, so that your mind can help every limb of your body move. Now, the next phase of that is understanding the game and then basically having the ability to train every part of your body to respond to those brain waves firing to that point. So like, you need to have control to your fingertip down to your toe. Let everything come from your mind, knowing where to come from, and knowing where to go. So pretty much, if you know where to go, you can run fast and jump high. Now, if you know how to run fast and jump high, you're good. Everything else is easy, right? You just react to where you need to go, where you understand. So I think an athlete's intellect and understanding the game or their position or their plays or just how their body functions itself, then having the ability to move the body in those positions to do it, you have like a library of ways to like create a play, right? You can jump, dive, backhand, forward, you know, whatever, however you want to do it. So I kind of think those are important. Everything else takes care of itself.
And as you were learning the position, because the biggest thing I've noticed from working with Ricky and just watching him train is how in depth it actually is with route running and the techniques and lowering your hips and getting out of breaks. I'm like, the average fan just doesn't understand this. And then on Sundays or Saturdays for college or whatever day they're watching football, they get pissed off at a receiver for not doing something, or it looks like, and there's so many different levels. What kind of speak to that? And also, what was your experience with learning the position like when it comes to that side of things?
Well, you're right about the depth of the receiver position, right? It's kind of a space that is like a beautiful art in a way that if you figure it out, you figure it out. And I feel like the guys that actually figure it out are the ones that like, like their careers aren't like the craziest, like the most lavish. Like they are the ones that just kind of like went through it, you know, hurdle after hurdle and figured out how to get through each step of it to understand it all the way down. So those are like some of the best teachers. But some of but watching the guys that could do it so effortlessly is why fans think it looks so easy. Because there are some guys I watch and I'm like, I don't know how he got in out of that break so smooth. Like,
yeah,
I don't know how he did that. So there are some people that just have that ability to do it. But then there are some people who have to work at that art. And the art of it is deep. It's deeper than just running the route and coming out and catching it. It is like manipulating another person. And the other person's actions are, you know, you can't predict. Like, you can predict, but you can't predict, right? So you're, and then you have all these different variables that come into it, like traction on the ground, you know, the defensive scheme, the play you're running, the weather, the quarterback has to throw the ball, the O-line has to block, splits, depth, then you have to catch the ball.
Yeah.
On top of that, right? So, like, there's so much that goes into it that you're right. So the untrained eye, it just seems very easy, like just run over there and catch the ball. If only it were that easy.
And I think a lot of casual fans, they don't understand the timing of football. You know what I mean? Because even myself, who's watched football since I was seven, been a fan of the NFL, fan of football in general, played football in high school, obviously. And now I've really started to realize, just from watching Ricky, the timing from quarterback to throw the ball to the receiver, the process is just so much faster than you would realize. It's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy fast. Like, I kind of still operate that in my daily life, where like I move really fast. Like, I think really quickly, like to get up to the huddle or to get out of the huddle, right? To get in the huddle, hear the play call, know what you have to do, which is memory. And then not knowing what you just have to do, but also knowing what you have to do down and distance wise, according to this defense, run the route, now go against the player. Like, this is going through your mind as you're jogging out to the line. Then you line up, you got to figure out where your split is to run the best route, to have the best leverage, to get the best outcome. But sometimes the outcome isn't always best for you. It's better for another teammate. So now you have to figure out, am I running this route to get the ball? Am I running it to get somebody open?
Yeah.
Right? It's a lot. And then you finally get to the line and you're standing there and then you look out. Then there's the defense and you try to analyze defense based off of what you see. And sometimes their pre-snap read is not their snap read. Then you have to adjust. And then you're running a route within 4 seconds, catching a ball, thinking about all of that quickly. Yeah.
It's also why we see some players have all the athletic tools and then they're not able to succeed and even go pro or make it from high school to college. Moving on somewhat to your professional career, what was the combine process like as far as talking to NFL teams? I know you were extremely successful in college when it comes to your kick return game, from at least the numbers I looked at. It was like 26 to 27 yards of kick return every single time from what I saw. So like, and then you also had your track speed. So what were those conversations like pre-draft? And were there also any kind of weird questions like we heard about when Darius Geis was coming out?
Yeah, I didn't get any. Actually, I did get some weird questions, but not too crazy. Shoot, the NFL combine was definitely like probably number one most stressful week of my life, I think. I want to say it was most stressful moment to like the rest of my career to describe it, where I was so anxious because I've been waiting for that since I was like a kid. And then I'm there, and then everything there is right. Like, everything I want is riding off of being there in a way. And you've seen what you saw on TV over the last couple of years. So you're like, wow. But where they don't explain to you is like 3 days leading up to the on TV running. Like, it is like running you through the mill. Like, you get there, you hop off the bus, drop your stuff off at like this random hotel room, you meet these random people, they tell you where to go at some point, then you hop on the bus, go to the hospital, you do like your general medical stuff for a couple hours, hop back on the bus, come back, like eat, move around, then they kind of tell you where to go, and you have all these informal interviews where you have to meet with all the teams. So you're like waiting to talk to all these teams and like put on your best face and your best foot forward, like all day and all the time, and really don't have much time to relax.
Guys
have done it a little bit better than I did. I just guess I didn't prepare for it as well as I should have, but it's a very stressful time, where it's a time for you to show the scouts your personality, time to show the scouts your smarts, you know, see you in person, talk to people, you speak to coaches, GMs, you have your formal interviews, which is the full like brass in there, like everyone who's in charge of something is in a meeting. I had a couple of those. Like, the craziest one I had was, I think it was the Jets at the time. And I had gotten in trouble for something in school, like education wise. I think I had to like serve like a half suspension for like being late to class or something. Not my proudest moment, but it happens, right? It's in college. And I remember like this guy popping up from behind the bar being like, "So what happened here during this game?" And he was nowhere to be seen. Like he's legit like behind the bar sitting down.
Yeah.
And it's dead silent. And dude just pops up out of nowhere and asks this random question. And that's kind of like what happens. Like you kind of get that flow or people just asking you random questions, trying to like get a rise out of you, see how you react. It's all good. It's all good. Just be prepared for like them trying to figure out how you react if somebody on the field throws something at you. So
what was the Wonderlic test like?
It was cool. Actually, it was cool. The Wonderlic test was cool because like I kind of wanted to, you know, see how smart I was compared to everyone else. And I actually did pretty well. Like I did really well for the receivers, which kind of got me drafted a little bit higher because they could see like, you know, cognitively, like he's not stupid, right? Not saying that was the point, but he's witty. It's like a bunch of just seeing how you think, like finish this sequence, you know, stuff like that, like shapes. Sometimes there were word problems, there were numbers. There was all sorts of cool stuff in there. So
some people make a big deal about it when it comes to quarterbacks. How much do you think that test actually determining factor of how successful a quarterback is going to be or player is also going to be?
Well, I think it's important. I don't think it really has that much importance, but I think it's important to be able to decipher patterns and sequences. It's kind of what football is. Like you kind of, if you can see something, if you can remember like 3 steps before to get 3 or 4 steps ahead, it's kind of like chess, right? It's kind of like that, where if you can see the sequence, you can figure out the next one, possibly process of elimination. So from a quarterback standpoint, you keep seeing something, it's got to be this. And you have to be able to decipher that pretty quickly. So the Wonderlic test is kind of like that. But there are definitely other ways. They're trying to think of all sorts of ways to change that. So I'm working in the East-West Shrine Bowl right now, and they're not doing the Wonderlic. They're doing another test. So, okay. But it's very similar in type of cognitive ability. So,
yeah, because especially even with high school, I'd feel even more so than college, their just athleticism takes over. It's even more important to understand what their understanding of the game is compared to other guys. Because
especially at the pro level, you're right. The pro level is different. You're kind of a little more even when it comes to athleticism wise. So, your feet don't always make the play, your eyes and mind have to make it, then your feet.
So off of that, your first introduction to the NFL was getting drafted by the Bills. What was that first season like? Was training camp kind of a surreal experience? And you also were part of Ryan Fitzpatrick's career, who's now been in the league, it feels like, for a century. What was he like as your quarterback, too? To add on to that question.
Well, I will say this. I'll give a plug to Ricky. So I met Ricky that January, and he actually helped me out through so much, like told me a little bit of what to expect and how to move. And I was just saying the other day, I was like, if I had not met Ricky, I think I'd have been like light years behind in some type of capacity, like route running and just kind of not overall knowledge, but just kind of like the NFL type of style.
Yeah.
So getting to Buffalo was like, it was pretty cool. First off, to get drafted was like probably one of the coolest moments ever. Like I just remember sharing that experience with my family and just kind of being like, yeah, all that hard work makes sense now, because I've been throwing the ball over my house since I was probably like 7 years old, like just throwing the football, just hanging around the football all the time for it actually to make sense.
Yeah,
like 23 years later, right? Perfect. But no, so like the first couple of days of football were like, first couple of days in general were surreal. Like I remember just showing up and being like, all right, I have a clearance pass. I guess I'm supposed to be here. And you walk in, you're like, oh, I have a locker. I guess I'm supposed to be here. And you're like, okay, there's a jersey. Yeah. All right, did I put this jersey on? Oh, I go to practice. Are these cleats mine? And before you know it, you're like, I'm on the field. Look at that. Look, there's like Mario Williams. Look, that is CJ Spiller. That is so-and-so. You're like, oh my God, right?
Yeah.
But after a while, you realize I belong here, right? Then you get to training camp, and training camp is a different monster. Training camp is when you get to see like the real football come out, which is actually probably the coolest moment. You're like, cool, I get to really just play football as hard as I can. Like to a degree, you can't do that on all levels. Like in college at some point, yeah, but you're going to run into somebody that just doesn't belong there at some point. In the NFL, you can literally just go. I mean, someone's going to stop you, but they're probably doing it in a way too that's very creative and artistic. So it was actually pretty cool. It was pretty tough though, because it was like rookie year in a way. I'm gonna get my haircut, I'm gonna get hazed. Not saying that was a thing. At the same time, that was a thing.
You wind up with some wild cut.
Yep. And then you're talking about what Ryan Fitzpatrick. Like, Fitz is definitely probably one of the smartest football players I've ever met, for sure. Mm-hmm. Very smart. Very on and off the field. Did perfect Wonder League score, I think, or he missed one, I think.
I think he had like a 50 or something like that.
Yeah. Yep. Something stupid. Yep. So he's probably one of the smartest guys I've ever met. Like, he can understand those sequences and patterns very quickly. Like, his process of elimination is probably faster than anybody, or he just knows it.
what was his personality like? Because he's had the highest of highs in games. You know, we'll see him throw for 400 yards and 5 touchdowns, and then he has the lowest of lows. So what do you think has kind of, from interacting with him and being on a team for him, because I think he was gone from the Bills the next season.
Yeah,
I believe.
Yeah,
right?
No.
So yeah. why do you think was the biggest factor in his career kind of taking that path?
Like I said earlier, he's really smart. So I don't think anyone that's a billionaire or those really smart individuals has not failed at some point taking a risk. Mm-hmm. And those risks aren't really what are highlighted. Those aren't highlighted. Like, only in sports are losses highlighted. Like, no one should ever talk about how many games. No, actually, no one really cares how many games Tom Brady lost, if you think about it, right?
Yeah.
Because he's a champion, right? To that degree, like, Ryan Fitzpatrick has won a lot of games with his smarts, a lot of games, and he's tried stuff in other spaces that didn't work, but he's still been playing for how many years? So clearly whatever he's doing is working.
There's a reason he's going to be a starter again for Washington.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He's that type of individual. So I think it's just because he's able to, you know, balance it out up top in his mind with his mental, like, his body is able to do it a little bit longer, and he doesn't have to rely on his body as much because he can intellectually process it and, you know, take those hits off when he doesn't have to, but he does take hits and delivers them.
To what extent do you think that the situation a player is drafted into makes or breaks their career from a success standpoint?
100% makes a huge difference. So if you get drafted to a team that chemistry wise you don't fit with, it's tough, right? So, but being drafted is a blessing. Being drafted is cool. Being drafted gives you the guaranteed money that a lot of, it's what you want, right?
Mm-hmm.
So to a degree you want that, but you really can't pick, which is why they're drafting you, basically saying you don't get a choice.
Yeah,
we're just taking you. So you can either take that, or you can always decline it and pick where you want to go, right? You sure can. But at the same time, I think it's very important, especially as a receiver, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the year I got drafted, there were a bunch of, like, you know, speedy, fast guys. And I thought I was going to Indianapolis. I was going to go play for the Colts, right? And
with Peyton.
It doesn't matter.
Peyton.
That would have been Andrew Luck.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, now that situation is different, right? So now you're there with a young quarterback who they clearly are going to give some time to build with. And you're a rookie as well, so you have time to build with them. And anytime they need to build and work on stuff, you're probably going to be their first call. So once you get that rapport down and you're on the field, case in point, T.Y. Hilton, right?
Mm-hmm.
He had a great career. So I think those are important, right? Very important, very important. And just willingness for them to, like, kind of have patience with you.
You made it to the NFL. You realized your dreams from when you were a kid, and you played in the CFL, and you ultimately had a successful career, all things considered. Done something that basically 99.9% of people who have football dreams aren't able to realize. But what advice would you have given yourself, or when you look back on your professional career, would you given yourself to have given your career maybe a little bit more longevity, or would have helped you been more successful and effective in the years you did play professionally?
Yeah, well, to kind of sum all that up, I tell my younger self to keep grinding, but be smarter about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of, like, lazy but tough guy my way through a lot of situations, because kind of what we were taught, just kind of, you know, push through it. I feel like that's an old school mentality, right? Because there are guys who are just saying no to stuff now and saving their bodies and then getting to that same spot you're at. And they are, like, way fresher than you are. They're way healthier.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to lose that battle every time. But hard work does get you pretty far ahead. So I just continue to work hard. I just do a little smarter. All those injuries that you have kind of build up, or it's not even that you have the injuries. It's just avoiding the situations that put you in those problems, right? Just being a little smarter, because the body is what you need. Your body is your asset. Your body is your money. So you have to take care of it and think about that from a younger age. So I would kind of go back to it like that. I feel like I hustled pretty hard. I was always doing something. I was always doing something to the degree of I still hustle that same way now. So I would never change that, but I would just do a little smarter.
Are injuries kind of what shortened your NFL career?
For sure. I got injured after my second year. Like I was actually evolving kind of into the receiver that I always wanted to be. Mm-hmm. And I kind of just was pushing my body as far as it can go. Like I gained the weight. I put on the muscle. I lifted heavier. I ran fast. I did everything right. To the degree, your body at some point is like, yeah, nah.
Yeah.
So once you reach that point, after that, you're just kind of holding on. But it's cool that some athletes don't ever get that point, or they kind of just slow the flow of water.
Yeah.
Coming out. Like slow the bleeding, right? If you can slow it down, you can kind of keep, because it's really it. But some things mm-hmm. happen where it's just tough. Everyone's body is going to break down. The guys that get to walk right and just say, I'm done.
Yeah.
Those are very, very, very rare.
It's also so weird, like how everyone's body is so different. And I think it's something definitely from my experience in high school that a lot of high school coaches don't understand. Like myself, I had 4 surgeries in high school. And then I'm thinking I was going to play on the next level, Division 2, at least. That's kind of what a lot of people around me were telling me. And then injuries kind of derailed those dreams. But then you see, I'm like, oh, I should have trained, done this and done this. But like, evidently some people make it through and their bodies make it through. Mm-hmm. So it's crazy how a lot of people's bodies can handle certain levels of work differently. And then there's people like Eli Manning who seem to never get injured.
Yeah.
They're always healthy, and somehow the crap knocked out of them sitting back in the pocket and somehow always get back up. Kind of off that question, you played high school, you played college, you played in the NFL. Who is to you the biggest what if player that you played with or played against? Either their careers were completely derailed by injury or off the field issues or some other type of something that interfered with their ability to pursue their professional career.
I think I have two for you. So my first one was a running back I played with in high school. That was mm-hmm. Matt Ball. Was probably like the baddest white boy running back I've ever seen. Like saucy, like played really high level point guard style, but at running back, like very mm-hmm. smooth, like just would flow through the defense, hit it when he had to. We could run fast, strong, very explosive. But he like tore his ACL a couple times. Yeah. So like we never got to see it. And he's definitely one of the most athletic people, definitely probably one of the most athletic people I've played with. And I would go on to say like pro, I don't want to miss somebody, but I got a chance to play with Sammy Watkins for a little bit, just seeing how explosive he was up close at some point. And then knowing that he's kind of injured now, I'm like, man, had that kid stayed healthy, it would have been a wrap. Like he would have been, like he's still really good. But to a degree, like his explosion is not like what I ever saw it was. Like he, when he came into the league, it was like, this is what they're making down there. Like, like my mindset was, I needed to train harder this offseason. I thought it was going to be cupcake. Is this what I looked like last year? Right? Mm-hmm. You know, so
he was the number one guy out of that class. Just kind of as when people look back on his class, unfortunately for him, Odell and Mike Evans are drafted after him. Mm-hmm. So he's definitely a big shadow that part of it. Yeah.
He's that good though.
Yep. For me, it's always Victor Cruz, because as a New York Giants fan who grew up watching him, he was for the one season, probably the best, in my opinion, slot receiver in the NFL. Then he wins the Super Bowl with the Giants, has 2 good years after that. Odell gets drafted. Then he doesn't get to play any games with Odell. And then tears his knee and then misses a whole year. And I never get to watch him play prime Cruz play alongside prime Odell. And that always upsets me.
That's how it goes though. You know how it goes. Injuries are that, you know, how it goes.
They're such a bummer.
It's human. It's just like human error, right? Humans are, we're not perfect, right? If they're robots, I'd be upset, but we're not robots. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where you have to understand that, right? Mm-hmm. We're not robots. Like you're not a robot. I wish you were, right? It's be a little bit, you know,
it would be nice. And the healthiest teams also are the ones that are the most successful, it looks like, at the end of the day. Because of the Super Bowl, we had the Chiefs lose their tackles, and all of a sudden they can't block the Bucks because they have 2 of the best edge rushers in the NFL. Who are your favorite receivers to watch now Is there someone in college maybe, or a few pros that you love to watch because of their game and what they're able to do on the field?
It's slightly embarrassing what I'm about to say. Since I've been retired, 2-3 years now, I've just been taking a break from watching a lot of football.
Really?
Yeah. I coach it right now, and it's brought me back into that space. And I watch guys now, but I don't watch it to like enjoy it. I watch it to analyze it. So I'm just getting back into that point of like enjoying football. Like I'm just like, this season might be the first season I watch and enjoy the whole season instead of feeling like analytical about it. So it's like the first time that I'm able to kind of enjoy football again compared to watching it as like a player. Like it was hard for me for a while to get to that point, because every time you watch it, you're watching it analytically instead of watching it like for entertainment. So, but I'll give you a few. Okay. I'll give you a few. I like Jarvis Landry. I like his hustle. I like how he plays. I love that. I love that. I love that part of his game. I kind of tuned into to kind of like watch some of his offseason training. If I'm being super cliche and easy, like Tyreek Hill to me is exactly what the football needs. Really fast guys that can play football. And there's a lot more guys out there that can do that. They just need a little more specified training into some specifics. Like I feel like not all track guys are bad football players. There's just track guys that run really well that need to understand when you run fast, certain things pop up on the football field that you need to be aware of. And then shout out to all of my guys that I've played with, for sure. Every guy that I've played with that's still playing, like those are definitely my dudes. Like I think I'm probably everyone that's still playing biggest fan. To a degree, I'm like, you're doing exactly what I wanted to do and you must do it. Like, keep going. If I can help you, I help you. I want to help you play longer. Let's go. Yeah. Through you, I'm going to have fun.
So who would you mentioned Tyreek Hill. Who's your wide receiver totem pole as far as that goes, like top threes? Is Tyreek number one for you? A lot of people seem to take away from him because he doesn't have the height, or a lot of people have Devontae number one or DeAndre now. And some people have, a lot of people sell Julio. So what is your totem pole look or rankings look like?
So for that? The 2008 high school class, Julio was our number one receiver. So I'm definitely going to go with our class, right? If Julio's still playing and we're the same age, yeah, Julio's still number one for sure, right? Big, fast, can run. Man, it's controversial. I like Keenan Allen. Keenan Allen, to me, he's from North Carolina at the same time. He actually runs some of the best routes in the game right now. And he doesn't get enough publicity or credit. You know, Devontae Adams is catching the ball from Aaron Rodgers most of the time. So to a degree, that's super easy, right? To a degree. You know what I'm trying to say. I'm not saying it's easy, right? I'm not saying what he does easy. But having an ace in the backfield throwing in the ball is like so much simpler as a receiver. Like it just comes to where it should be. And if you can catch, you can catch. But he makes really good plays. But I would definitely say Tyreek is up there because of his skill set, and me having a similar skill set, I must support him. But I'm more of a Julio, Keenan Allen, let's go with Cheetah. One, two, three.
So a lot of people, if they hear you say Keenan Allen too, and I definitely agree with the fact, kind of flies under the radar because he's been with the Chargers and he's been injured, torn his ACL once. He doesn't get as much love, which is kind of weird compared to the DeAndre Hopkins and the Devontae Adams of the world.
Like D Hop has just good hands. Like D Hop is just good ball skills. Like I like the route running. It's creative. It's artistic, right? Julio is to me, like you can have a conversation between D Hop, Devontae, and Julio all day, right? All day. They're all similar to me. They just kind of all do it very similar. Very tall, lanky, still skilled, fast receivers. I think it's cool. But the other two are different. So Keenan Allen runs routes better than anybody, and Tyreek Hill runs faster than anybody. So
Julio, still when I watch him, like, well, he does everything well. So
exactly. So his age is just it. But I did get to see Calvin Johnson play in person a couple times. So man, that's a different person. It's a bigger Julio.
Yeah. He was 6'5" running a 4.2 or something like that. It's so crazy when you look at, I saw some stat just randomly about him that he started playing in the NFL, retired in the NFL, and was inducted into the Hall of Fame all while Tom Brady was still playing and is still playing now, which is so crazy to think about. Came to the league after him, Brady was in the league, I think, for 7 years by the time he came in or something like that. Yep. And then he has a long career. It becomes one of the greatest ever and then retires and is in the Hall of Fame while Brady just won a Super Bowl. All right. Well, that is all the questions I have for you. I greatly appreciate you coming and doing this interview for me. I should have it posted sometime this week, depending on when my schedule allows for me to edit and get that part of things done, because that is the longest part of the process, unfortunately. Yep. Just once again, thank you. I appreciate it. And hopefully we can maybe talk in the future again.
Yes, sir. For sure. For sure. Easy money. I think this is cool. I appreciate you having me on here. So
appreciate it. And if you're watching, if you somehow found my video and you don't know who TJ is, or Do It For The Gram on Instagram, I think, right?
Yep.
TJ Graham, give him a follow. Appreciate him for doing this. And I'll see you guys in the next interview.